Good morning, Strasburg United Methodist Church. I'm so happy that you have joined us today for worship. No matter where you are, or where you're from, whether you live locally or beyond, we are happy that you have joined us today to learn more about God. Today is Sunday, March 14th, 2021, the fifth Sunday of Lent. We're almost to Easter, almost to that time of celebrating the resurrection. But today we hear a few more stories about God and about Jesus, and I'm just happy that you're here with us. Just have a couple of announcements to share with our congregation, and I include you in all that too, even if you live far away. We are trying to assemble items for our newsletter for the month of April, and if you have anything you'd like to contribute to that, please email me or drop that by the office by this Sunday, March 21st. Secondly, we are collecting for Compassion Cupboard, which is our local food bank. And this month, we are collecting tuna fish and mayonnaise. You can guess, you can make tuna salad with that. And that's what they're giving out this month for Compassion Cupboard. Now, if you have other items to give, we always accept any canned goods. We have a couple of drop boxes in our community that we can fill up. So don't limit yourself to just those two things, but you could drop most of that stuff off to our church office or leave it on the front porch of the church, and I will make sure that it gets into the church and over to Compassion Cupboard. Finally, we are still doing our Wednesday night suppers. We haven't been able to host them in our fellowship hall, but we have been working with a local catering company, and actually this next week, the town council of Strasburg and Queen Street Diner are going to be offering the meal. And we hand out about 100 meals every Wednesday night to those in need and to those who just need a little bit of human contact. If you would like to receive a meal, just stop by between 4 o'clock and 4:45 on Wednesday nights in the parking lot over at the Lutheran Church. Well, that's about it for my announcements today. I hope you all got some rest. I know that whole springing ahead thing can be a little stressful. And so maybe you're tuning in to this worship service a little bit later than you're usually going to because you just didn't get enough sleep last night. But if that's the case, may God bless you and keep you as you go forward in this day. And maybe you get an afternoon nap. Will you join with me now in our opening prayer? Almighty God, through Jesus Christ, you bring salvation to the world. Give us strength to believe in him, that we may share in his victory over the power of death and fulfill the purpose for which you have made us. For he dwells with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Rich Giersch and I have prepared some music for you today, and I hope that you enjoy them as much as I do.
Lord, I hope this day is good. I'm feeling empty and misunderstood. I should be thankful, Lord, I know I should. But Lord, I hope this day is good. Lord, have you forgotten me? I've been praying to you faithfully. And I'm not saying I'm a righteous man. But Lord, I hope you understand. I don't need a fortune and I don't need fame. Send down the thunder, Lord, send down the rain. But when you're planning just how it'll be, plan a good day for me. Lord, I hope this day is good. Understood. I should be thankful, Lord, I know I should. But Lord, I hope this day is good. You've been the king since the dawn of time. All that I'm asking is a little less crime. It might be hard for the devil to do, but it would be easy for you. Days. this day is good.
Will you join with me in singing Grace Alone? Every promise we can make, every prayer and step of faith, every difference we will make is only by His grace. Every mountain we will climb, every ray of hope we shine, every blessing we left behind is only by His grace. Grace alone, which God supplies, strength unknown He will provide. Christ in us, a cornerstone, we will go forth in grace alone. Every soul we long to reach, every heart we hope to teach, everywhere we share His peace is only by His grace. Every loving word we say, every tear we wipe away, sorrow turned to praise is only by His grace. Grace alone, which God supplies, strength unknown He will provide. Christ in us, our cornerstone, we will go forth in grace alone. It is now time for us to offer a prayer of thanksgiving for all the many gifts that God has given us. I have been amazed by the generosity of the people of Strasburg United Methodist Church, especially as we have continued to feed our community, even for those who have been willing to give to our children and our children's ministry, to our camps. Camp Overlook is one that we've needed to help, and then Shenandoah Alliance for Shelter. And so thank you very much for your generosity. This is a difficult time for many, and we've had more than a few come into our church needing help. And so thank you for your generosity today. Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for your wonderful works among humankind. Accept this offering with the dedication of our lives, and help us be for the world an emblem of your steadfast love. In Jesus Christ. Amen. Will you join me now in our prayers for the people? Sisters and brothers, confident in God's love and mercy, let us pray for the world and for our needs, saying, Merciful God, hear our prayers. Holy God, you created us in Christ Jesus for good works. Help those who profess faith in Christ to do good in the world, following the way of life you have prepared for those who believe in him. For the Church of Jesus Christ, merciful God, hear our prayers. Your children walk by your light, doing what is true. Yet salvation is not earned by good works, but through trust in your grace. Dispel from your children arrogance of heart, that the world may be drawn to your truth by their humble witness. Merciful God, hear our prayers. In every age, you call forth men and women of integrity to lead your people in the way of righteousness. Help pastors and teachers fulfill their calling. Give them courage to speak the truth in love, and shield them from temptation to misuse their authority. For pastors and teachers, merciful God, hear our prayers. God, your reign encompasses all the earth, though the nations may rebel against your justice. Save the nations from the wrath of their disobedience. Help them to dwell in peace and promote the common good. For governments and leaders, merciful God, hear our prayers. You hear the cry of the sick and the afflicted. Save them from their distress, heal them of their disease, and deliver them from the destructive power of suffering. For all who sorrow in distress, merciful God, hear our prayers. O God, in Jesus Christ, you have shown your love for the world. Receive our prayers, grant us what we need, save us from perishing, and bring us to everlasting life, as we pray the prayer your Son Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Will you join me now as we say the words of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Will you join me now as we prepare our hearts to hear Scripture today, as we pray our prayer of illumination? Almighty God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, open your word and illumine our darkened world, that we may see clearly and live faithfully by the light of your truth in Jesus Christ. Amen. Our gospel lesson today comes from John chapter 3, verses 14 through 20. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The words we hear this morning are famous words. They are familiar to most Christians. John 3:16 was one of those first verses that I remember learning as a kid. This verse is still one of the few that I know by heart. These words of salvation are startling because they say so much in such a little package. They almost tell the whole of the Christian story in one sentence. What's striking and startling about these words is that they are spoken to a Pharisee in the dead of night. This isn't Jesus telling this to a large crowd on a hillside. This is Jesus speaking to one man who is searching for truth. Nicodemus sneaks away to see Jesus because his life has been changed by the events that he and everyone else witnessed at the temple. Jesus swept away the money changers, and he challenged the way of worship, and Nicodemus wanted to know why. In this passage from John, we read about this soul-searching conversation. Nicodemus asks why, how, when, and Jesus patiently explains to him what God's plan is, to save the world and draw the world back into the arms of God. Now, in some of those other verses that we don't hear this morning from chapter 3 of the Gospel of John, Jesus tells Nicodemus about the necessity of being born again. Now, Nicodemus at first doesn't get it. How can a grown man go back into his mother's womb, he asks. But Jesus gently says, no, it's a spiritual rebirth that is accomplished by the cleansing action of water and the Holy Spirit in baptism. We join this conversation between Nicodemus and Jesus with a strange phrase. Just like Moses lifted the serpent up, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. This verse refers to a story in Numbers, where Moses is directed by God to place a serpent on top of a staff so that people who are bitten by poisonous snakes may be resurrected. So these words that Jesus tells Nicodemus are a reminder to Nicodemus of God's saving action to the people of Israel through Moses, and a way for Jesus to be seen on the same level as Moses. Jesus, like God through Moses, can raise people from the dead. Jesus can offer eternal life to those who have faith. And that's how we set up the famous words. And how we hear those familiar words have become a cliche For God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but may have eternal life. It's a great verse. Like I said before, it's almost the whole gospel in a nutshell. But you know what? We can't forget to keep reading on. We have to hear another verse so we don't get caught up in the trap of becoming judgmental. See, it's too easy to think that this verse sets up a system that relies solely on our decision to believe in God or not. What Jesus says to Nicodemus in the next verse is key to our understanding of God's grace. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn it, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Jesus did not come to judge. He came to save. What a glorious message. We are cared for so much that God came to live among us and guide us to the right way of living. When we remember the stories of Jesus meeting the woman at the well, or visiting Zacchaeus, or even when we recall the stories of some of the more unsavory disciples, we know that Jesus offers grace and compassion and forgiveness to those people that society has already given up on. They are like those people that we have given up on in our communities when we say they aren't church people. We, as humans, may judge them, but God does not. Instead, he sent Jesus to welcome them into the kingdom. Some of my favorite parables are the ones where Jesus speaks about seeking lost things. He tells the story of the woman who sweeps her whole house to find one lost coin. He speaks about a shepherd who leaves behind 99 sheep to find the one lost lamb. And who can forget the story of the father who waits patiently by the gate for his prodigal son to return? All of these stories are descriptions of God's love and grace for the lost, the searching, even for us. Nicodemus, on that night that he sneaks away to see Jesus, is searching. Who knows what's going on in his head? Who knows what the catalyst was for his doubting of his own traditions and way of life? Was he at that wedding in Cana and saw the water turned into wine? Maybe. Was he at the temple when Jesus swept through and disrupted worship? Probably. But whatever it was, he risked his reputation and his status to see this man named Jesus because he saw something exciting and dangerous and wonderful. Jesus, in his last few words to Nicodemus on that night, talks about light and darkness. Jesus says to him that people love darkness because it hides all kinds of evil. I think we know what Jesus is talking about. We know what happens behind closed doors. We know that some of the most callous corporate decisions are made in shadows where public scrutiny is absent. We know that our temptations and our impulsive actions happen in the dark. Jesus says this is our nature. And so it's a little funny that Nicodemus sees Jesus at night. That imagery is so striking. Here we have a man secretly meeting Jesus. And Jesus says to him, "Those who do what is right come into the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God." One of the lessons I learned as a child was don't lie. It's simple, really, and it's so true. One lie can cascade into 1,000, especially if the lie is repeated and believed by a great many people. You can certainly complicate your life with one lie that is to be covered up by many, many more. So the best advice that I give to my children and that you probably give to yours is not to lie at all, because then you won't have to spend all your emotional and physical energy covering a lie that you told long ago. In the same way, living in the light, living according to God's purposes, is much better than pursuing darkness. Now, it's not always easier. Jesus told us that, but it certainly should be our goal. The purpose of this conversation between Nicodemus and Jesus is to demonstrate the compassion that God has for all of his people, not just the religious leaders. This one-on-one conversation reminds me of the conversations I have with my wife. The two of us are always working towards a common goal in our marriage. We always try to do what is right, and we always try to build each other up. Yes, we have our disagreements, and we have moments of stress, but we are always there for each other. You know, God does the same for all of us who seek the Creator. Jesus tells us that you and I and the whole world are sought after by God. Whether you are lost like a sheep or a coin or a prodigal son or prodigal daughter, whether you are searching like Nicodemus or whether you are already found like one of the disciples, Jesus is seeking you and inviting you to live in God's light. Now, there are many of you who are watching this who have been lifelong Christians, but I know that there are some of you who have to discover once again this message of God's love and compassion. And if you're one of these people who is still searching, who is still struggling with the story of Jesus and God's love, but has been moved by these words from the Gospel of John, I want you to pray with me right now. Now, you don't have to open your mouth. You can just pray silently. But know that God desires this conversation just as much as Jesus desired to have that conversation with Nicodemus so long ago. So let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you for your Son, Jesus. We thank you for the love that you have given us to forgive our sins. We thank you for the promise of eternal life. Lord, you know that we love the darkness. You know that we run away from you. Forgive us, transform us, strengthen us, so that we may be children of light that speak your truth forever. Amen. And now I have a message for everyone else. God's compassion doesn't end with personal interactions between Jesus and individuals. As Christians, as people who have taken on the name of Christ as our identity, we have the joy of sharing God's love with others. Part of sharing that love comes in telling the story of Jesus. But much more of that joy comes in how we treat others and how we welcome them into our church and into our lives. And I challenge you to act like a child of the light. That may mean you need to have a rule of life. You need to have ethics. You need to put aside your anger. You need not cheat. You need not lie. And not only that, when you look around and see other people around you, see them with the eyes of God and open your heart to compassion, patience, and love. Now, these are just little things, but added up, all of these little things can reveal God transforming the world. And when you do these things, you'll be reflecting the light of God to everyone.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever. The Lord be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever.